Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and we will be discussing the basics of one of my all-time favorites, synovial joints, in this learning objective. So this will include the basic structure as well as composition of all synovial joints, and then we will finish by describing a few of the more common accessory structures that are in association with some of the more complex synovial joints. So the synovial joints will be the focus of the majority of our conversations during musculoskeletal anatomy due to two reasons. First, they are the most numerous type of joint, and particularly when we're talking about the appendages. So it's hard to avoid a synovial joint when discussing musculoskeletal anatomy. Secondly, as synovial joints are freely movable, or capable of more movement, this also lends to a reduction of stability in these joints, say compared to a suture in the skull. And with a reduction of stability, clinical issues tend to arise. Synovial joints are unique in that they articulate or join bones, not by a solid sheet of connective tissue, but rather by what's referred to as an articular capsule, that is a sleeve of connective tissue that's enveloping the articulating bone, so thus connecting the sides of the articulating bones. So not this solid sheet like you see here in, say, a suture, which is a fibrous type of joint. This organization allows for a greater range of motion in synovial joints than in the other types. And there are other factors that greatly affect how much motion is allowed even amongst synovial joints. There are four structures that all synovial joints have. And this first one we just mentioned, which is the articular or synovial capsule. And this is the connective tissue that is actually connecting the bones to one another. So it is going to be this kind of enveloping on the sides of the synovial joint. It will provide protection to the inner portions of the joint as well. It's going to have two parts. It will have an outer, more fibrous layer, as any outer layer typically is. And that's actually going to be continuous with the periosteum of the bones. The periosteum is a complex connective tissue covering of bone. Additionally, there will be an inner synovial membrane. So the inner portion of the articular capsule is actually a synovial membrane that will secrete synovial fluid into the joint cavity. And synovial fluid is going to be a large topic of conversation. It is this extremely slippery lubricant, which is kind of viscous, slippery type texture, similar to what you see in raw egg whites. And as mentioned, synovial fluid will be discussed quite a bit in a clinical context in upcoming lectures. But functionally, understand that synovial fluid plays a role in reducing friction at a joint. It also importantly provides nourishment to the articular cartilage and will play a role in removing waste from the joint cavity region. Now let's discuss the other two structures located within all synovial joints. The articular or synovial cavity is the literal space between the two articulating bones, but within the articular capsule. So in illustrations like the one that we see here, you generally see some giant space. All this blue right here is supposed to indicate the articular cavity, but there really isn't a lot of space within a true joint cavity. But the fact is that there is some. And the fact that there is space allows for easier and more movement in these types of synovial joints. Lastly, all synovial joints will have articular cartilage. So this kind of white portion right here is indicating the articular cartilage. And these articular cartilage will cover the ends of the articulating bones. And I want to note again that this cartilage is not what is actually connecting the bones. That is the articular capsule. But the cartilage does serve to provide protection and to reduce friction within a synovial joint. As you likely know regarding cartilage, it doesn't have a very robust vascular supply, especially compared to some of these other surrounding structures. And thus, articular cartilage is going to be slow to heal after injury or with wear and tear. Articular cartilage will be discussed in considerable more detail when discussing osteoarthritis, or the wear and tear type of arthritis, as this area of the joint is very often affected in OA. Now, ligaments often don't make the list of structures found with every synovial joint, and I don't really know why, to be honest, because ligaments are associated with pretty much every joint, synovial or otherwise. And I guess they're just so important that they really need their own spotlight. And I don't mind spending a little time talking ligaments. So we are finally discussing true ligaments here. So not any of those peritoneal ligaments that we talked about before, but a true ligament is connective tissue that connects bone to bone. And the structure and locations of ligaments can vary widely from a component of the outer portion of the articular capsule, so often referred to as a thickening of the articular capsule, or it can be completely separated or extrinsic to the joint capsule. And we'll be discussing both types as we get into the specific joints. Ligaments play a huge role along with their close neighbors, tendons, which connect muscle to bone, in the structural integrity of synovial joints. Additionally, ligaments can play a role in checking action, so only allowing certain actions to occur at specific joints or only allowing a certain degree of range of motion. So we will spend quite a bit of time getting into some of the specific ligaments. Now on to what we often call accessory structures of synovial joints. So structures that are not located in all synovial joints, but typically just the more complex ones. But you'll find that we will actually spend a lot of our time on those more complex synovial joints, as they are the ones that tend to show up clinically. All three of these types of structures, so all three of these structures right here, are composed of fibrocartilage. Just how it's organized is going to be different. A labrum is going to look like kind of a lip of fibrocartilage that is going to be located on the socket part of a ball and socket joint. So in essence, that's going to be the shoulder and the hip joints. And this allows for a slightly greater surface area associated with the socket, and thus allowing a slightly better fit for the ball portion of the ball and socket joint. Articular discs are more substantial pads of fibrocartilage, and these are going to be located within an articular cavity, and they typically serve to divide the space within the joint. So often it will kind of say if this is the space, the articular cavity, you could have an articular disc of fibrocartilage that kind of divides, here's space, and this would be the disc. And that will compartmentalize the actions that can occur at that joint. So the classic example of an articular disc is located in the temporomandibular joint, or the TMJ, but there's also an articular disc in the acromioclavicular, or AC joint. And lastly, menisci are shallow and incomplete pads of fibrocartilage that often appear kind of a crescent moon shape. And these are most commonly associated with the knee joint, which we're looking at right here. And this will play a role in absorbing shock and pressure, and it will very slightly improve the fit between the bones. So you have two menisci associated with the knee. Lastly, I want to discuss bursae, which are associated with synovial joints, and particularly in areas of increased friction. And these are sac-like structures. I kind of like to think of them as mini synovial capsules with a small amount of fluid, but missing function of articulating bones. These can be located between adjacent muscles. It can be located where a tendon passes over a bone or between bone and the skin. So potentially located in a multitude of areas. There are even specific specializations of those smaller scale. So here's an illustration of a bursa. So the smaller scale bursa, you can have these elongated kind of bursa-like structures associated with long tendons. So these in blue right here are going to be examples of tendon or synovial sheets. So this kind of specialized bursae for long tendons. If a bursa becomes inflamed or enlarged due to excessive friction or other injury or a multitude of other factors, this is referred to as bursitis, which is a fairly common musculoskeletal clinical condition. So more to come here for sure. Most excellent. I do love discussing synovial joints, and this basic understanding of the common structures of a synovial joint will make upcoming more detailed discussions of the major synovial joints more meaningful. Please do take time to review and reach out with any follow-up questions. I thank you for your time and attention.